Well, good morning, and welcome to Community Life Church. I'm Scott Veroneau, and I'm the lead pastor here at Community Life, and it is an honor to have you here in our family room today. I'm assuming that most of you are still in your PJs or just chilling. Who knows what you're doing, but it's awesome to be able to connect by means of internet. We had some struggles in the last service, but I think not here. The world site that hosts us was really struggling, but we're figuring all that out. So some of you may be dialing in on Facebook today, thinking about you and praying for you, and just so glad to be able to gather. And so with that said, we're going to give you 60 seconds to go ahead and get all your levels set, to get you a cup of coffee, maybe text a few friends and let them know that we're going live on Facebook, or you can go to our website. You can send them whichever way you want to, but so good to see you this morning. We're going to have a great service. So go ahead and take this 60 seconds and have some fun. There's a light you don't notice until you're standing in the dark. And there's a strength that's growing inside your shattered heart. God's not done with you, even with your broken heart and your wounds and your scars. God's not done with you, even when you're lost and it's hard and you're falling. So don't hide, don't run, 'cause God's not done with you. All right, so I found one of the benefits, actually two of the benefits of this corona quarantine thing. One of them is the fact that I'm married to my wife, and she's the worship director. So no matter how much we're quarantined, we can always do church. And then we just engage the kids too, right? Yeah, Nate and Micah and then Pip, we're going to adopt Pip. He's going to come home with us today. So we're going to keep having church. And the other one is I get to set the temperature at whatever I want it to be in the building. And people aren't freezing out. So everybody else in here is looking for jackets. But it's going to be a wonderful morning. So glad to have you here today. I know that it's just crazy what's going on around us. And so I encourage you just to sit back, relax, and allow your mind to just kind of be consumed in what we're going to talk about today, worship. We're going to study the Word. It's just going to be a great time. And so with that, will you join me in praying the Lord's Prayer together as we get our hearts together on the same page? Let's do that. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that you've provided us a means to communicate and to connect with one another through this internet. But Lord, the most powerful thing that we need to realize today is that there's nothing that's ever going to destroy the ecclesia. That as a people, we're called to gather. And whether we do that from 6 feet away or whether we do that through technology, we get to gather our hearts around the one that's given us life, and that's your son, Jesus. And so today, in the midst of the fear and the anxiety and the uncertainty, we stake our claim in the one who is certain, and that's your son, Jesus. We love you. We thank you, and it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. We are so thankful that you've logged in to worship with us. I think now more than ever before, it's so important that we together, regardless of where you're located this morning, are worshiping him together as a church, and we're lifting up the name of Jesus in spite of everything that's going on. Can worship make your troubles disappear? Probably not, but I'll tell you what it can do. I believe that it brings emotional stability to our soul this morning. I believe with all my heart that as we sing the words of the songs, as we lift up the name of Jesus, your you're actually speaking to your own heart and your own soul and your own mind, and you're encouraging yourself, and you're allowing the Holy Spirit to connect to you in a way that's so powerful. And so that's what we're doing this morning. My son this morning on drums, thanks for joining us, Nate, and my daughter is singing, helping us, and of course y'all know Pip. So we invite you into our living room this morning to worship with us, and let's just give him all, find a quiet place, focus on him, and let's see what God wants to do this morning. What is this love that won't be led? That's calling out with heaven's breath. Who is reaching wide to save our souls? Only you. Come on, sing it with us. What is this grace that makes no sense? We could never recompense. Who gives us all a second chance? Only you, only you, only you. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God, no one. There is no other God who can save. Thank you so much just for being there for us, that you're a constant help in the time of trouble. In the Old Testament, we all know of King David, and there's a scripture that I wanted to read from Psalm 40, 42 and 11 that says pretty much what he was living for so long, and part of the reason that he wrote the Psalms. It says, "Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God." We know that David was on the run and he was hiding out in caves. Maybe some of you feel like you're hiding out in caves. We all can relate to that a little bit. But why so downcast? I've heard so many times this week about just being discouraged. And this word can bring life. I believe as we listen to Christian music, as we fill ourselves up with the word of God, that it can be an encouragement to our souls. So let's just continue to worship him as we lift the name of Jesus up this morning. Let's just give him our hearts and everything that we have today.
Of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. There is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes and wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your mind to those around me. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Upon your love.
I tell you, it has been such a crazy week. I know some people are quarantined, but I feel like I've worked harder in this last week than I ever have before in my life. In fact, the team has worked harder than they ever have before, and we're all learning how to be comfortable in front of a camera. I see Kristen and her team, they're shooting stuff out on Facebook. Clint and Nikki, they're doing crazy stuff. Jen is actually having to talk on the phone. She's not just texting. And so she's back there answering needs all over the place. It's just been crazy as we try to reinvent and lean into what it means to be the church and continue to connect. I was reading through, trying to keep myself grounded and, as a pastor, and continue to navigate forward. There's two lanes that I've got to think about in my life, and one is the organization of the church, and then there's the ecclesia. And so I'm reading through scripture as I go through in Ephesians chapter 4. You discover this fivefold ministry calling, which are the prophets, the pastors, the teachers, the evangelists, that God has put in place to govern the church. But what he says the reason for those are to, number one, equip the saints, and number two, to build up the church. And so in this time and in this season, that's the lane that we're supposed to be in. We connect people to Jesus. That's our mission. But we've got to equip you, and we've got to build up the church. And we're finding ways to do that. Kristen this week threw a text to me, and she said, "Hey, what do you think about doing drive-in church?" And so we've talked that through a little bit until we figured out it's problematic to figure out how to do all of that. People sitting in their car smoking each other out with exhaust fumes. So I'm not sure if we'll be able to do that, but we're coming up with all sorts of ideas. If you have ideas and things that maybe we're not considering, let us know. We want to continue to be the church and meet your needs. And as I get up here to pray about the offering, or pray for the offering, I should say, these are unsettled times, and I, as a pastor, am not willing to ask you to do something that you can't do. I know that there are those out there that have resources, and if you're able to, we would love for you to give, and we're going to continue to funnel the resources right to where the need is and continue to be the church in what we're doing. So if you're able to do that, I encourage you to give, clc.life/give, and continue to help us as we move forward. Just kind of excited about the challenges that we have in front of us. It's a new day for us to sort all of this stuff out. The exciting thing is none of this surprises God, and God holds all resource in his hands. And so as I'm in the lane of thinking about the organization of the church, we're going to look different going forward because we've got to make sure that we match what the need is in the community. And so we're going to be working on all that together. And so thank you so much for joining us in that. And if you will, let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for just this opportunity to gather. What a different world that we're facing, God. And coming into 2020, and the first month and the second month in, just things were rocking and they were moving in the right direction, and I had it all figured out. So many of us, we all had it figured out. And then you reminded us who God is, and that our hearts and our lives, ultimately, they rest in your hands. And so as I pray over this offering, Lord, it's not about the finance, it's about the people. God, that as a church, you would help us to meet the needs of those that are here in the community, to love and to care for them and to meet those needs. Lord, as we pray and as we seek new ways to connect, as people have been locked into their house for a week and for the unforeseeable future, God, we're not really sure what that looks like, but I pray that you continue to help us to reinvent and reinvigorate and help people to just connect in new ways. Lead us and guide us, Lord. I pray for all the people that are out there today that are worried about work. They're worried about what tomorrow looks like, let alone what 2 weeks looks like. You do hold all resource in your hands, and it's in you that we trust. There's no question that after all of this is done, our paradigms will be shifted, and we'll have a whole new perspective, God, as we find our hope and our trust in you. So we pray a blessing over this offering. God, we love you. We thank you. And it's in your Son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
But I know you're on to me.
want to be. Seems like every time I try to make a run, it all comes down on me. You say, honestly, you won't give up on me. And I shall believe. Show me your face tonight. Oh, 'cause I know it's true, no one heals me like you. And you held the key, yeah. Never again, oh, I turn away from you. I'm so heavy tonight, but your love is all right. I do believe, oh yeah, that not everything is gonna be the way you think it ought to be. Seems like every time I try to make it right, it all comes down on me. We say, honestly, you won't. Shall believe. Oh, I shall believe. That not everything is gonna be the way you think it oughta be. Seems like every time I try to make it right, it all comes down on me. We say,
doing good today. It's still, I'll never get used to hearing an echo of my voice back in this room. So I look forward to the day when we're all back in church and able to worship together again. I hope everybody's doing good this morning. A couple quick announcements before we jump into the message today. The first thing I want to tell you about is we started this actually long before all of this craziness unfolded. We had a team that was doing this. We will start tomorrow morning and work through a 30-day prayer journal. And so if you're one of my prayer journal folks out there, or if you're looking for a new way to get some good insight or information in your heart, this might be the perfect way to do that. So tomorrow morning, we're going to release a video. I'm going to start. I'll do the first one, and then the staff, and we're going to alternate back and forth, and we're just going to take a day, read the scripture, and talk to you for a few minutes about how we connect to it. But I want to encourage you to be a part of that for the next 30 days, to really allow God to do something deep inside of our lives as we all pray and we all kind of get on that same page. If you want to find the prayer journal, it is on the website. You can go there. If you click on that main little bar in the middle and drop it down, it'll be at the bottom there and it'll take you to the link. And what we're going to do every week, we're going to look at them in weeks. We're going to pray. We're going to memorize scripture. So for some of you out there, you're like, we need to be memorizing scripture. You got that. So we're going to memorize scripture. We're going to meditate, we're going to praise, we're going to connect, we're going to serve, we're going to talk about different ways to give for our neighbors and all of that during this time. And so I just invite you along to join us in this journey. And then also if you're, and I'll talk to you at the end of the service about the next part, the signing up for the needs and the volunteering. Well, we are in our Easter series, and I'll go ahead and tell you just a full disclosure up front. As we sat down in worship planning, we talked about whether or not we should shift our series and do something different. So the world around us has completely changed, and we just are plodding forward with our Easter series like nothing's happened around us. And you know, as I thought about that and as we talked through it, I like what we're doing, and the reason I say that is I think that there's something to be said for some sort of normalcy. Everything else around me has changed. My life and my rhythm and everything that I normally was accustomed to is gone. So I don't want to change this series, not just for me. I think for the church, that we can all still continue on in this process that we're in. Now, here's what I do know, is that it's so interesting how as we go through and we read this scripture in this Easter series, it connects not only to the disciples and what they're going through, but it connects right here to 2020 and what we're walking through. So it doesn't mean we can't connect to the picture of what's going on outside of our doors. It's just I'm not going to go and do something different and talk about fear and talk about those different things. I'm just going to continue to talk about the Easter series. And so we're in this series called Making History, or Making His Story. And as you can imagine, as a pastor, as a preacher, there's the challenge every year of telling the same story and not allowing it to become monotonous. Like, we want to tell it in a way that will re-engage people that have heard the story multiple times. So this year, we're looking at it in terms of if we were to sit down to make a movie out of the life of Christ, what are those big moments that we would capture and that we would put on the big screen? And so that's what we're doing, these seven-ish big moments that we've recorded and that we're going to study as we kind of go towards Easter to look at what those pieces would be like. And so just to kind of tell you, we started off in week one, it was the prophecy. And we had Simeon and Anna when Jesus, the baby, was born, the hope of the world. You think of a beginning of a movie and how exciting that will be. There's chaos that's ensuing, but hope has been born. And Simeon and Anna stand up and they start to proclaim or start to prophesy from the scrolls of Isaiah that there's one that's come and this is going to be the one. And so you see in the very first sermon that beginning of the story. And then we talked about the proclamation. Jesus, as a man, goes to his synagogue back into his hometown and he proclaims from the Isaiah scroll what he's going to do. And as he stood there in that place, it was so amazing for the people that were in front of him to hear those words until he challenged them and let them know that their mindset was too narrow and that this proclamation wasn't just for them, it was for the whole world. And so we see our hero that was born now has maybe a different vision for the world, and people get angry and they try to kill him at that particular point. But he makes his proclamation. Then last week we talked about the preparation, John the Baptist. This was that moment where John was passing the baton, if you will, to Jesus, and he was going to pick up that movement that John had been calling for people to repent and to bring their hearts back to God. And Jesus would take that group of people that had started to repent and turn that into a full-blown movement, if you will, during this time and this place. And so in that sermon, we were able to see John wrestle through his faith but get to hear about what Christ was doing. We got to see Jesus start to reveal new things about the heart of God and how he feels about us, how he values us. And ultimately, he speaks to that one little nagging aspect through the whole story that ultimately will nail him to a cross, that we like to fashion God in our image. He says, I can't win with you guys. As John was here, you said that he had a demon, and I came and you said that I'm a drunkard. But let yourself see what takes place and what unfolds and see if what I say doesn't bear out to be true. And we got to see that in the preparation. Today, we're going to talk about the revelation. Next week, we're going to talk about the push. And so if you want to read ahead, you can go to Luke chapter 9, verse 51, and 10, verses 1 through 12. This is when Jesus turns his ministry and starts to head towards Jerusalem. He heads towards Jerusalem, towards those final days, and everything is ramped up, and all of the people are ready, and he sends out his 70 disciples to prepare for those last days. That's called the push, or the turn and the push. And then the next week is the paradox. How can people one moment say, save me, and the next moment say, crucify him? And then finally, we're going to talk about the peace, which is just a perfect message to be dealing with during this time. So you've heard about week one, week two, and week three. Today, we're going to talk about the revelation. And maybe if I was to put another title on this, I would call this sermon, Dying to Live. Dying to Live. And what's not lost on me is many of you are at home, you're like, I'm dying to go do something else. They've closed the beaches. It's like the end of the world, right? Like, that was our last place to go. But we get it. So we're all dying to go do something, to live. So allow this message to speak to your heart. We're going to be looking at Luke chapter 9, verses 18 through 27. And you can imagine that John the Baptist has handed the mission off to Jesus. So Jesus is now picking it up, and he's going to carry it on and move forward. And from that scripture that we read to now, let me tell you a few things that Jesus has done. So we're looking at making history or making his story. So John passes the baton to Jesus, and then Jesus goes out, and he immediately starts to break all of these social norms. So he elevates the status of women by including them in with his disciples. So Mary Magdalene, even though she's cured of multiple demons, she becomes a part of his team. All of these other women are joined around him. Then he starts to hang around with tax collectors and sinners. And this rabbi does the unthinkable. He hangs out with people that nobody else would hang out with. People that were considered to be sinful and lost. That's where Jesus anchored his ministry. And so all the social norms are flipped upside down. And then this crazy thing happens. Jesus and the disciples are on a boat, and a big storm comes up, and they're all afraid to die, and Jesus walks out on the front of the boat, and he speaks to the storm, and the weather changes. How cool would that be to be able to pull that off? But think about that, for the disciples to see something like that happen, how that would shake you to your very core. And then just to go ahead and add to this, he raises another person from the dead, a young girl. And then ultimately after that, he sends his disciples out on a test run. Knowing what they knew, growing to that particular point, he sends the 12 out into the different communities to start spread the word, to share the news of this gospel message. And then when they come back, he does something amazing. He feeds 5,000 people. It says, the scripture tells us, 5,000 men, which means that they didn't count the women and children. So you could probably assume that that would have been a group of maybe 10,000 at the least. And he feeds all of them with 5 loaves and 2 fish. And it caused me to wonder to myself, maybe we should get Jesus some toilet paper and let him expand that toilet paper, right? You think that's a good idea, Jim? If he can feed 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fish, what could he do with my pack of Charmin? I don't have any Charmin. But it's amazing when you think about it. But now you know what this Jesus is doing, and people are amazed. I was trying to connect the context. No? Okay, good. All right. So I need a laugh track in here. Would that work? Yeah, that'd work. I need a laugh track. It'd be funny. So then Jesus now transitions to this place, and you're going to remember the scripture because we just studied it not long ago in Matthew. And this is where we're in Caesarea Philippi, and this is when Peter figures it all out. So remember, they're right outside the cave of the god Pan. Now, isn't it interesting that we are now in the midst of a pandemic? I'm just saying. So he's in this particular place, and this is the scripture. I'll go ahead and read it, and then we'll come back. So Luke chapter 9, Kristen's working the camera. She doesn't want me to move, not even a foot, so I'm going to come back over here. Luke chapter 9, verse 18, and I do whatever Kristen says, so I got that. Once, when Jesus was praying alone with only the disciples near him, he asked them, "Who do the crowd say that I am?" And they answered, "John the Baptist, but others, Elijah, and still others, that one of the ancient prophets has arisen." And he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And we all know this. This is when Peter stood up and he answered, "You're the Messiah of God." Or if you read in Matthew, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And if you remember in that text in Matthew, Jesus said, "Whoa, what? Like flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father which is in heaven gave you this insight." But something shifts in Luke. So Luke doesn't have the rest of that part of the story, but he kind of enters a different section for us to think about. In verse 21, it goes on to say, "He sternly ordered and commanded them not to tell anyone, saying, 'The Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised.'" Imagine that shift that would have happened in their minds and their hearts as they're hearing that. Like, what are you talking about? Verse 23. "Then he said to them all, 'If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will save it. What does it profit them if they gain the whole world but lose or forfeit themselves? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words, of them the Son of Man will be ashamed when he comes in his glory and the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. But truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God.'" And so, wonderful scripture. I love when you can take two passages, one from Matthew and one from Luke, and put them side by side, when one gives you a little bit more of the story and one gives you a little bit more of the story, then you can mash them together and you can kind of get the full understanding of what it's all about. And so let me just for a moment go through, teach the scripture, and then come back, and I've got really just one point, and then I'll turn you loose to the living room or to the yard, if you will, to go have fun today. These jokes aren't going to work a week after today, so I'm just going to go ahead and put them all out there. All right, so Jesus is there, verses 18 through 20. Jesus has gathered his disciples together, asked them who he is, and Peter gets it right, and he nails it. He says, "You are the Messiah of God." And it's just amazing that he gets it right. And Jesus doesn't deny it. In fact, he says, "Oh, okay." I mean, like in Matthew, we find out that he says, "Oh, Peter, that's awesome. Like, flesh and blood has not revealed this to you." So he confirms exactly what Peter said. So I want you to think and put yourself in their spot for a second. As a disciple, Peter makes that declaration. Jesus confirms it. And you're like, "Yeah, baby, we found the Messiah. Not just the Messiah. This is the Son of the living God. We don't ever have to worry about anything ever again. Like, we're all good. It's all great." And then Jesus does something right there in that moment. It's almost as if he knows what they're thinking. And the very next step in what he does in verse 21 is he rips the Band-Aid off. Because what they're thinking is totally wrong. They're misunderstanding, and they're not even aware of what the Messiah is all about, that they fashion God, they fashion this response of God in their mind so clearly that they're missing the point on what's taking place. And so Jesus tells them in verse 21, he sternly ordered and commanded them not to tell anyone. Now, I want you to think about this. You find the Messiah, you want to tell everybody about it, right? Like, this can't be bad news. This has got to be great news. So let's go tell everyone else that we're all good. We got them. Come see them. We got them. Come see them. So it's got to be strange for them to hear Jesus say, "Don't tell anyone," like commanding them to do that. And there was a reason behind this, because Jesus knew that everybody had the wrong idea and people would immediately come out and try and kill him before his time was there. And so you wonder if maybe that's not why he said that. But he goes on in verse 22 saying, "The Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised." How odd would this have been able to hear this? "I'm the Messiah," or he was revealed as the Messiah. "But I want you to know that the Messiah, who you think is going to be X, you think this Messiah is going to be a king, he's going to rule, he's going to do all of this different stuff. Well, I want you to know that's not the case. This Messiah is going to be subject to great suffering. He's going to be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and scribes, and he's going to be killed. But on the third day, he's going to be raised again." Imagine the disciples as they had to struggle with this. And to me, as we think about the making of history or this movie, there's a big turn in the script, if you will, right here in this particular moment. So up until this point, the ministry of Jesus is flourishing. We've seen a foreshadowing when Nazareth got frustrated and tried to kill him. Jesus is saying, I can't win with you people. So there's an underlying current, and now Jesus tries to shift the minds of his disciples. He actually tries to engage them, if you will, in this greater story and this greater narrative. And so he tells them about what's going to happen. And then verse 23, he says something that I think would have shocked them to the core. "Then he said to them all, 'If any want to become my followers,'" and then he finishes the sentence. Isn't it weird to think about that? Imagine if you were one of the disciples and you'd been following Jesus for 2 years. And then Jesus gets up after this declaration is made by Peter. And he says, "If any want to become my followers." Now I wonder what they must have been thinking at that moment. What have we been doing for the last 2 years, right? Like, what's he trying to say? Like, are we not one of his followers? What's this all mean? Then he goes on to say, "If any want to be my followers," and then he gives us a list of three things. "Let them deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me." So if you're interested what this message might be around, or if you're looking for a way to be a follower of Christ, these three things, Jesus lays them out for how we can be a follower. And so he tells three things to the crowd that's in front of him. "If you want to be my follower, deny themselves or deny yourself, take up your cross daily, and follow me." So it's so interesting that he says that it's in those three things that we discover what it means to be a follower. So Jesus is flipping the script, if you will, on the disciples. So they thought it was going to be one way, and now he's getting them to see it in a different way. So it's important for me that you know that, because he's going to try and engage them and help them to understand what it means to be a follower. Now, verses 24 through 26. Now, I'll be honest with you, these were tough verses. And so as this week we were testing out some of Kat's new technology, and we were using Zoom meeting for our Thursday night Bible study. And these three verses we talked about for a long time. And I'll just tell you that these verses are tough. They're hard to read, they're hard to listen to. And if we were going to be honest, we would say that many faith systems that would lean more towards the judgmental side would take and they would stand up any one of these verses and they would use them in a way that it would be very difficult to maybe proclaim. And I'm not telling you that it's wrong in the way that they do that. I'm just telling you that it's dangerous. And so for me, I want to look at these verses in context. And I believe, honestly, that these three verses speak to the first verse, the denying of self, the taking up your cross daily, and the following me, that I think these three verses are associated with what Luke was writing or what Jesus was saying. And so let's just work through this. That may sound all confusing, but let me just go ahead and work through this. So the first thing he tells us to do is to deny ourselves. In verse 24, those who want to save your life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will save it. And so this deny yourself, the very first part of this is almost as if we make a decision. That we make a decision and we realize that our self is broken. That even though ourselves try to convince us that we can be in control, that we can take care of things, that we can be out in front of everything, that there is just the inability to control and accomplish and handle every single thing that's thrown at us in life. That we are literally powerless to save ourselves. And so when you look at that verse in light of deny yourself, then I think it makes sense to us, because really he's saying there's a decision to be made and you need to reconcile with the fact that you cannot save yourself and that yourself is broken. So make that decision. The second verse, or the second part of this, take up your cross daily. Now, first of all, you got to recognize that word daily gives us this aspect of there's something to be lived out. And so if the first one is a decision, then the second one is a way to live our daily life or how we move forward. Really, our pursuit or our focus of our lives. And so just think about this phrase, take up your cross daily, and then let's associate the scripture with it. What does it profit them if they gain the whole world but lose or forfeit themselves? And so this talks about the patterns of our lives, how we would go out and try and gain the whole world, that the total sum of our days and what we choose to do is amassing things for ourselves, that we would go out and gain the whole world. So if you attach this to take up your cross daily, Jesus is trying to give us a bigger message. Now, something you have to wrestle with, this phrase, take up your cross. If you're going to read this scripture and understand it in context, you have to be aware that the disciples didn't know at this point that Jesus would go to the cross. So you have to think about what take up your cross might mean in that context. And so I've been studying this all week, and I had a few folks that sent me some different thoughts on it. And the thing that most jumped out to me is really two aspects. The first is this. If you see someone bearing a cross or taking up their cross during Roman times, you knew that they were doomed. That they were carrying their cross and they were literally walking to their death. And so their fate was sealed, that they had given their fate up. But if you took and you carried this beyond one more step, that cross was associated with whatever they were crucified with or going to be crucified with. And if you think about it in terms of Jesus, this is where you get this picture or the challenge, if you will, of humanity. To me, the cross will forever stand as humanity's greatest challenge. Are we going to create and form God in our image, or are we going to allow God to be in his image and let him create us in his image? And so Jesus, he ends up on the cross because we rejected his image, the way that he chose to live life. And so the cross became known for, or was known at that time as a branding or as somebody's form or instrument of death. And so when we carry our cross, we understand that we will be identified by Christ. So this message that was spoken during this time would later mean something to the disciples. It would later mean something. So Jesus put this seed, or he put this thought out there for them to hold on to. And so take up your cross daily. So it talks about making a decision, letting that pattern start to live out in your life. And then finally, the last part, follow me, he says. He says, follow me. And you think of verse 26. Now, I'm going to tell you verse 26 was the hardest for us. He says, those who are ashamed of me, in my words, of them the Son of Man will be ashamed when he comes in glory and in the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. This verse was so difficult and so problematic. And once again, I think in the church world that we've used this verse maybe as a whipping post. And what I want you to know is that the word ashamed, it's a very powerful word. If you've ever had someone that you love and that you care about deeply ever look at you and say, I'm ashamed of you, it cuts you to your very core. Like it rattles you to the very core of your being. And so in looking at this scripture, a lot of times the way the church has interpreted this is to say, if you find yourself in a situation and you don't speak up for God or you don't represent God in a certain way, then this verse kicks into gear and God's going to be ashamed of you on that final day. And I just don't see it that way, because I know that in my life, maybe early on in my faith, there were moments when I didn't have the faith or the courage to stand up. But I'm going to tell you right now, I was never ashamed of Christ. I was never ashamed of my belief and my decision to serve God. I just maybe hadn't grown in my faith and gotten to that point. And so I think there's a bigger truth here to understand when we attach this verse in context to follow me. And so if you go back and you connect it to this verse, follow me, those who are ashamed of me and my words, of them the Son of Man will be ashamed. If you attach it to that, then if you're a person that's ashamed of Jesus to the point of choosing, what will happen is you will choose not to follow. So if you're ashamed of him, then you literally don't follow him. You won't follow him, which brings you back to step number one. And so you will have missed the point one, which is deny yourself. So if you're ashamed of Jesus, you basically are saying, I choose my way and not your way. And so I think there's a bigger context to this verse and how it all works in there. And so hopefully that makes some sense into what we're looking at in this terms of follow me. And then finally, so make a decision, live that thing out, and Jesus, follow me. Jesus would be our identity in this world going forward into living a different way. Those are the three things, I think, if you're going to talk about what it means to be a follower. And then finally, verse 27, and I love this verse. He says, but truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God. And Jesus in that moment is talking to the disciples that are in front of him. And we think to ourselves, well, who got to see it? Right? Like, who's the person who got the glimpse of seeing what it would look like? And I'll tell you, just processing through this, in order to have a kingdom, you need a king. And these disciples were there on the day that Jesus rose from the dead. And they were there on the day that Pentecost unfolded and the Holy Spirit came forward. And this new awareness and understanding of how to live in an upside-down kingdom where you are literally dying to live, where you're giving your life for someone else. When they started to live into that and they understood that principle and it became a part of their lives, then they were able to experience the kingdom. Sometimes we trick ourselves into thinking that it's a place, a building, a property. It's not. It's the lives and the hearts of the people that are around us. When somebody makes a decision for Christ and they choose to live into that, when they take up their cross and they daily follow Christ, they become a part of that kingdom. And when people look at that person and they see the way that they're living, they get to experience and see kingdom in their lives. All of us have the opportunity to live into that. And so for me, to put this whole scripture back into context of our movie, Making History, this is that part where they found the king. Right, but in their zealousness of finding the king, they don't necessarily understand the role that this king is going to take in changing the world. And so they found the king, but there's an issue. There's a problem. And we're going to see that become a problem even more as we go on forward in the next part of the story. So you may say, Scott, what does this have to do with me? As I'm locked up in coronavirus town, what does this have to do with me as I wrestle through with the scripture? And please hear me say this. I honestly believe that when the world is at its absolute best, let me flip that. When the world is at its absolute worst, then there is a clear distinction between the world and the kingdom of God. That I honestly believe when the world is at its absolute worst, It's in that moment that people should be able to see a clear distinction between the world and the kingdom of God. And here's what I would say. If you woke up at any day during this week and you had a freak out moment, like you just said, oh, man, what is going on? Everything's crashing. I'm not sure. I don't know. If you woke up in that particular moment, I would say, great. You are tracking along with the rest of the world. And here's what I would say, that I think God has given us a gift. Don't hear me say that God has given us a pandemic. God has given us a gift in all of this, a gift to see just how little control that we actually have, just how little control we actually have. If we go back into this scripture and you think about the disciples and you think about Peter, at this particular moment and moving forward, they found the Messiah. Well, like, what else do they have to worry about? They're locked in, they're loaded, everything's good. And in their minds, we've got the military leader, we got the king that's gonna come in and conquer the world, the one who's gonna be the defender of the Jewish nation. We know what this kingdom is gonna be like, what it's gonna look like. Man, it is game on, baby, let's go. Like, that's where they were. And then in a few weeks, when that first whip hits the back of Jesus and it tears the flesh away and blood starts to run down his back, I want you to know that they all stood back and said, wait a minute. Wait a minute. How can that be this? Like, what? Where's our military leader? Where is all of, what is it that's supposed to be next? Like, how are we supposed to do this? And their whole world fell apart. And their whole world just started to crumble to the ground as they lost control, and everything that they thought was going to happen didn't happen. And that's where the script is flipped upside down. And just tie ourselves back into the story. We sit here literally watching the work of our hands, years invested in the stock market, and our 401ks and all of those things just melt away, it seems like. We're living in fear of a sickness that seems to be imposing and working its way down from state to state, kind of heading our direction, and there's this fear that grips our heart. We're afraid for our parents. We're afraid for our children. We're not sure financially how we're going to make it, and we find ourselves hopeless with no control. And what I want you to hear me say, and please don't misunderstand this, what I want you to hear me say is this: welcome to the greater story. Welcome to the greater story, his story, because this is exactly where the disciples found themselves. This is exactly where the disciples found themselves. Their idea of what was going to happen fell woefully short. Their idea of what Jesus was going to do fell woefully short. Their thought about receiving favor and moving themselves up in the eyes of everyone else and maybe being elevated to a position of prominence, all of those things fell woefully short. Our ideas of what things were going to look like are falling woefully short. I remember coming into 2020, nervous about where we were going to be with finances and the church and the growth. And man, we hit January and February and we were rolling and it looked awesome. Like, I'm like, yes, we've got this all figured out as a church. And then this stuff happens. And let me tell you something, I was angry for days. I sat in my room just so frustrated about everything that's going on, and I realized I had no control. Because I was too busy, we were too busy trying to take and mold and shape God into our image, what we thought was supposed to happen. And I wonder with the disciples if at some point they weren't sitting there locked up, gripped in fear, and they looked around and they said, do you remember Caesarea Philippi? Do you remember when Jesus said, this is what it means to be a follower? We got to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and we have to be willing to follow him. This can't be about us because we just discovered we have no control. Well, I want you to know this can't be about us because we're discovering we have no control. But here's what I hope and I pray. I hope and I pray that the church wakes up. And when I'm talking about the church, I'm talking about the ecclesia, the gathering of Christ that understands what it means to deny ourselves, to make a decision to believe, to take up our cross, to make a decision day by day to walk out, to invent new ways to connect people to Jesus, to invent ways to help, to come up with ways that we can be able to serve in a safe way that will continue to connect people to Jesus, and then to follow him, to allow Christ to be the identity. This is the time. If there was ever a time for the church to be the church, this is it. Because no one else has the answers. Yes, the world is going to sort it out, and we're going to eventually wrestle things back into some sort of control, and everything's going to look totally different, but this is the time to connect people to Jesus, the only one who brings us peace and hope in these times. And you know, as I've this week struggled with this message and talked to people, there was someone who said to me, and I'm going to tell you, it was out of the honesty of their heart, and I get it. And they said to me, "Preacher, faith won't feed my family. Faith won't feed my family." And you know, in my heart of hearts, as I worked my way through that conversation, here today I think to you, I think it will. But maybe not in some form of sustenance that will feed you and then 2 hours later you're going to be hungry again. I think faith will feed your heart, it'll feed your soul in a way that food never could. I think that faith will do something in your life that will sustain you for the rest of your life, regardless of what this life looks like. We have been given an opportunity during this time to discover and to dive down and to dig into our faith in ways that we never have been given before. And I'll tell you, it scares me, makes me nervous. But I'm going to use it and allow God to lead and guide me, to guide this church, to guide our staff, and to guide our team to figure out what's next. Because people need Jesus. We all need Jesus. And so my prayer is that this sleeping giant called the church wakes up and that we stand in our rightful place. And so just as I close all of this together and you think about this narrative and the greater story, Jesus the King, they discovered him, they found him. And he starts to talk to the disciples about living in a different way. They didn't get it right away. Guess what? We're not either. We're going to struggle and we're going to fuss and we're going to fight. But ultimately, I think this is where that point of following me comes in and daily taking up our cross and following. Because God has given us the answer. And we have the ability to connect people to the source. And if you haven't had that opportunity in your life, I would encourage you to do it today. Just simply choose to believe that you're not a part of just a small story that's unfolding, that your life is whatever you can make it. I hope that you believe that you're a part of a grand story, a great story. And today, we have the chance to connect to that story and allow it to unfold. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we love you. What a different world. What a different day. God, we love you. In the midst of all of this that's unfolding, I choose to believe in the God of creation. I choose to believe in the God that when we wake up in the morning, we say, "Here I am. Let's see what we're going to do today." And you start to create and lead and guide in terms of this great story. God, you give us the words to write on the page. And today we've got a blank sheet of paper. All of our thoughts and all of our ideas, they're out the window. And you are helping us to write this script day by day, moment by moment. And so I pray that you would use us in an amazing way to represent you to a world that is destitute, broken, and lost. God, we love you. We trust you. And it's in your Son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Now, as Tammy plays this song, I want to just give you a few moments at your house, whether you're at the house, you might be at the park, who knows where you are, just to silence your heart and listen to the words of this song and see if they don't speak to you and maybe challenge your perspective a little bit.
If I rise, let me rise on you, not on all of my successes, my esteem or my pursuits. And if I lose, let me lose my life. 'Cause if I belong to Jesus, then the flesh is crucified. For me to live is Christ. For me to live is Christ. Oh, for me to live is Christ. To die is gain. If I grow, let me grow in you. With the seeds of wanting more, with being pried out by the roots. And if I'm still, let me hear you.
Count all of my transgressions, but the song of the redeemed. For me to live is Christ. For me to live is Christ. Oh, for me to live is Christ. To die is gain. My great desire is to be with you. Oh, but this is the place you chose for me. This is the place you chose for me to live my cross and give everything. And this is the time you gave to me. This is the time you gave for me to live is Christ. For me to live is Christ. Oh, for me to live Christ to die is gain. For me to live is Christ. For me to live is Christ. Oh, for me to live is Christ to die is gain.
Before I turn you loose to go to your kitchen to eat lunch, let me just share some information with you. Pastor Jen Lusher is a rock star. You guys may know that already, but what she's done in this last week is so remarkable. Trying to pull together resources and match resources with needs, and she's worked really hard to do that. And so when we can give high fives, y'all need to do that. Love on her. But what she's done is she's helped to put together a resource that we have on the webpage, our webpage, clc.life, where you can do one of three things. The first thing we're asking you to do is if you feel comfortable and safe and you would like to volunteer, we're putting together a list of folks that can help volunteer whenever that happens. So like we're matching needs with people. So some of that might be delivering food in the future. Some of that might be, I don't know. There's any sorts of things, but we need you to register. So if you can go online and do that, then we can go ahead and match up that spreadsheet so we can get those needs taken care of. The second thing is if you need us to pray for something, there's a prayer list that's there. You can go ahead and send in a prayer request. The third thing is if you have a need, or if you're struggling and you need us to come alongside you in some way, you can go ahead and register it that way as well. It's been a challenge to try and pull all of those things together, but if you'll go ahead and register, some of you're struggling with technology, like you're seeing my face, but you can't hear my words, and so this is not going to do you any good. if you're struggling with technology, let us know. We'll come and we'll help get you hooked up, or we'll talk you through it on the phone in a way that's safe, but we're just trying to meet those needs. So go ahead and connect and go through those three ways. I love that our church is responding in such an amazing way. We've got a lot of people that are signing up to volunteer, but we need more. So go ahead and let us do that. And with that, I will go ahead and pray and let you go. Heavenly Father, thank you. I love my church. It's amazing. I feel it stinks not being able to gather with everybody and share time together. But this is good for right now, because this is what you've called us to do. So help us to be the church, to step out and to love and to care for and to do the things that you've called us to do. We've been practicing for a long time, and now we get to be. So Lord, lead us and guide us. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You guys have a wonderful week.